Greetings, community, and welcome to the November Pen of the Avatar. We have a great show for you today. I'm here with concept art lead Stephen Dinelli, and we'll be looking at some cool stuff and sharing some good information. So we're glad to have you with us, and without further ado, the man you came here to see, Stephen.
Hey, community. It's great to be with you again. Gina, I love the purple hair. Is that permanent or just a little Halloween delay?
I haven't decided if it's permanent yet. I have to feel it out.
I like it. Go with it. Does anyone else in Alaska have purple hair? You have company.
No, I think I might be the only one. We've got some blue. We've got some green. Seems to be popular out here, but not purple.
That's because you're in
the woods. It's a shame, really.
You're a rebel. So, community, I just want to provide a disclaimer that we will be drinking on this show just a little bit today. So if you're offended by alcohol consumption, please just turn the show off for a few minutes. Then come back and join us because we'll be talking a lot about art. Where am I going to go? Oh, so today we're actually, I'm going to show you a little bit of a different process. As you can see, I am in Daniele de Casa and still got some Glenmorangie in here. Some of you might be wondering why we make a point of doing this every show, and it's because of you, community. You go out of your way to make our lives better. You've been supporting us for almost 2 years now, and we would not be here without you. So thank you for everything that you do. This is to you. On behalf of myself and the team, we greatly appreciate your support and continued support us. Thank you. So some of you might notice I have a interesting background decoration. That mannequin with the snazzy bra on that. I picked that up at something called Art Bra. It is for the Breast Cancer Resource Center of Central Texas. And they have a charity event called Art Bra where local artists design different bras. And then survivors and women fighting breast cancer actually model them on the runway. It was such a powerful show, and I love supporting them. I bid in the silent auction, and as fate would have it, I won a bra. That's game of chance. So I wish I could remember the name of the artist, but it's been over a year. In addition to that, if you are a member of our Austin community, we have a local event every year that we support for Austin Children's Services, and February 21st, 2015 is going to be our flashback 80s versus 90s retro dance party. It's got way too long of a title, but we just refer to it as flashback. So if you're following me on Facebook, you can see all the updates here, and if you're in Austin, you got to come. Best party of the year. And if you're thinking about visiting, February 21st is the best time. And on the back, on the other side, you can see that I've got the painting up on canvas that I'm doing for the marketing for Austin Children's Services. And then we'll actually be putting that painting in the silent auction. So it has been nearly 8 years since I've painted on canvas. And if you would like to own an original Daniele oil on canvas, this is going to be one of the few chances you're going to get. So do what you can to support Austin Children's Services, and thank you. This has been our community announcement. Oh, we should talk about that thing Lum posted. Lum, if you're with us today, I miss you. About saving the internet. There's actually an 800 number for the FCC, and you can get Tom Wheeler's email and email him directly about why it's important that the internet stay open. Please do that. Please be respectful and just communicate your honest feelings. The internet over the last 20 years has made so much possible, like Kickstarter and what we do. Imagine a world where you have to pay more money to get involved in Kickstarter just to actually support Kickstarter. It wouldn't be cool. I don't think any of us like the idea of that. And having the ability that we are one click away from Shroud of the Avatar to MSNBC or StephenDinelli.com, each as viable as the other in the realm of the internet, is it's pretty powerful. It's what's best about us. So do what you can to support that. Okay, today we are going to be exploring the Tower of the Shuttered Eye. And my setup's a little different here, but I'm going to go ahead and...
Let me make one quick announcement, if I may. I just want to remind everyone, I will be taking questions in the chat room. So make sure you participate and have fun. I'll be looking for your questions for Stephen. Anything art-related or process of development, we are happy to try to tackle. So I'm going to switch you over to Stephen Cam now.
That's dangerous. All right. I'm going to switch to my screen. And hopefully this is going to work. Come on, switch. All right, how's that looking? Okay, excellent.
Great, so, and I am now officially a disembodied voice.
How's my voice coming through?
You sound good.
Excellent. So you'll notice for you Photoshop users that my Photoshop is looking different here. And that is because I am using Photoshop CC, and I want to shout out to Matthew Kramer for turning me on to this. Adobe now offers Photoshop for $20 a month. So instead of paying the $800 to $900 that it would normally cost, you can actually get Photoshop $20 a month, and I'm sure they'll have updates each year. And I'm actually testing it out. One of the things that's kind of interesting, though I find it a bit distracting as I still learn my way around here, is you can actually control your panel. You can go darker than this. You can also go much lighter like regular Photoshop. But if you enjoy Photoshop and or you want to give it a try, it's definitely worth trying for 30 days. And then, as I said, $20 a month. You will need a beefy machine. My machine is 5 years old, and I've only got 6 gigs of RAM. So if it slows down too much, I'm going to switch back to Photoshop CS2. All right, so as you can see here, we have an image of the... There we go. Get all my fancy tools working. We have an image of the Tower of the Shuttered Eye, whereas I refer to it just Swamp Tower. I do that for organizational purposes. And how did we get here? So this was a different type of process, and I'm going to walk you through it. So Richard, Lord British, had written an adventure, the Tower of the Shuttered Eye, and so he wanted a tower, and you see our first image here is a version of Orthanc, which is this guy here. And I have that lightened, and that's the inspiration, a dark tower in the middle of the swamp. And here's some concepts or rough ideas just based on some existing examples that I found. One is a very Art Deco looking tower. One is a modern rotating skyscraper, and this is either in Dubai or going to be built in Dubai. Another one is your classic Wizard's Tower, and then this one I think is based on a Chinese building, just took it and stretched out the base, made it really dark, fortification-like. That's this one I'm talking about. So through that process, Richard really liked this guy here. And that's because part of the mythology with the Tower of the Shuttered Eye is that it is an ancient fortification built with monolithic stones. And this was actually my first version here, and then once we had talked about the monolithic stones and this being too contemporary, we went with these three options. And this was the final one that Richard went with. And I believe Andy already has this built and in game. And so I put together a little splash image. This, even though this is concept, this is what we've referred to as production art or production concepts. And that is detailed and literal enough that a production artist can look at that and make it with just very few questions. So that's where we ended up. And what I want to do with the Tower of the Shuttered Eye is create a splash image. So you can see here that I've just got this rough sketch and just kind of blocked in the shapes. The background here, I just used a screenshot from the swamp. Our art lead, Hutch, put together, of course I lost the image, the swamp, and it's gorgeous, dark, creepy, foreboding, and I want to incorporate that, so I just grabbed a screenshot of that swamp from him and then dropped it in as the background to capture those elements. Then I brought in the tower from the production concept, and then I've started painting on top of it, and then you can see that I've changed a bit here from the base. And the reason for that is I created a guide layer. Now, the bright yellow line here represents the horizon line. And the green lines and the blue lines represent the perspective points, two-point perspective. And then the red lines are actually just the horizon line bending with the perspective a bit. So what you'll see is that even though these lines on the tower are lining up with the horizon, they're not lining up with the perspective. So they need to line up with those green lines, not the red lines. Certainly it can line up here with the yellow line on the base, but the green lines are what that perspective is. So I made some changes, and I'm in the process of doing that, and you can see where I'm going with that. So I'm going to shut off that layer, and I'm going to go to our base here and just start painting, and I'm not sure why won't you let me paint? You are not hidden. I'm on this layer. Right? Oh, Photoshop, what are you doing to me? Uh-huh.
It's taking advantage of live TV.
It is. It's like, seriously? Okay, what do we have hidden? Do a Control D, make sure everything's available. I'm not sure what's going on, so I'm going to reopen the file. Save. Open it up again. Hopefully we won't have a problem. And we don't. Excellent. So software is getting a little sketchy. And if you work with Photoshop, you know that happens sometimes. So I'm using a okay, so this is normal. And we're not showing up. Normal opacity, 100%. Black. Okay, I have need to undo that. And let's create a new layer. Let's see what's going on. All right, I'm going to go ahead and restart Photoshop here because we're obviously having some technical difficulties. There we go. Z.
I have to admit, up until last year, I was still using Photoshop 7.
Yeah. All right, there we go. Oh, Lord. There we go. I'm not sure what happened there. As I said, my machine is a little bit slow, and I could just be losing memory. And I'm going to take my opacity and set it about 65%. And what that's going to do is give me a little more variation as I go through here. All right. Okay, it looks like we're flowing. Any questions from the community? How's everyone doing? What was your...
I think they were waiting for a sound bite, and I think they just got it.
Lovely. I'm glad I could help. So how was release 11, Gina?
It's still open. That for me is really exciting. I have been trying to get in all week, but my week has been absolutely nuts.
I know what you mean.
But I actually have a gaming date with my husband this week for us to go in and try some of the harder areas.
Yes.
And I promise to let him do the leading. Which is normal for us, actually, because I normally play a healer, because he needs a healer a lot. And not that he's not good, he just is crazy. He likes to just storm in and play the paladin kind of, you know, charge in, save the day kind of person. So, yeah, healer's always helpful. So that'll be cool, because it'll be my first chance to actually kind of kick back and play a support class.
Awesome. I'm excited about Shroud of the Avatar coming to Steam. And I'm looking forward to that.
Me too. And that's one of the reasons why my kind of week has been so crazy. Adding tutorials to the mix of things I already do. So getting those ready for R12 is a big priority, and trying to find a little time every day to get at least one of them written.
Excellent. Well, the easier it is for people to get into the game, the more people will see just how amazing it is. Normally in my process, I'll build up a, base in black and white, and then I'll go in there and do some brushwork and give it a lot of character. Because I've got a good idea of what I'm making here, and the fact that the production art for the tower is done, it's really about just creating the art and creating a beautiful painting that people can look at and get excited about what's going on in the projects and in the project and what types of places you'll actually be adventuring in. When Richard made his turnover for the Tower of the Shuttered Eye, I made a point of just looking at the map, but not reading any of the adventure, as I look forward to playing it through in its in the state, whatever he's thinking. I look forward to that surprise. Turn those guys off for the moment.
So I do have a question from Amber Rain.
Hello, Amber. How are you?
She wants to know, did anyone in the dev team take you up on your challenge? I think the Feeling Nuts challenge is what she's referring to. And did you find any time to get into R11 and check it out?
I did not have any time to get into R11. Unfortunately, the last few weeks have been insanely busy. And honestly, I think I slept. And, doing a lot of work, updating my site. Got a new toy, Cintiq here, and because my machine is older, getting this guy up to speed is taking some time. So, no, I haven't checked out R11, and as far as the challenge, I haven't heard anything from Chris, Richard, or Star. If they accepted or not, or what they did. So, Amber, that's a question from them. For them. It's like, hey, Stephen, challenge you. Are you feeling nuts? I know I'm feeling nuts every day.
Are you going to man up?
You going to man up? Man, put down the challenge. Where are you? Good question.
I would totally take you up on it, but I'm kind of lacking in the ability to do that.
Can we talk
about
that?
I gladly grab something else or someone else. There's your sound bite. You're welcome.
Yes. I love the Avatar Radio bit that Amber created with last month's show and those sound bites. That was badass. That was absolutely inspired.
I love finding how I've been, how my voice has been used creatively.
Don't we still have like a hidden spot with Lum's voice singing?
last I heard, that was still in the game, because I know he was hoping that it would be taken out as we added more music, and we still haven't taken it out, so.
Right, that's somewhere in Braemar, correct?
Yes, I believe it's in the graveyard.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Now we know. Okay, so looking at where we were and where we are, changing the perspective, but also establishing a lot of brushwork, keeping it loose and interpretive. And I know that begs the question, why do you want to keep concept art loose and interpretive? Part of it is every artist has their own style. And over the years, I have been striving to loosen up more and more and more. When I started in the late 90s, I was very realistic. And on occasion, there's still a need to do that. But with concept art, it's very much, this generation of concept art is very much about creating beautiful imagery. It goes beyond just illustration showing you what's there, but something that's very pleasing to the eye. And to stay current, it's something that every artist needs to be doing. So it's like, that's a stand of trees, but when you get in right on it, that's just a bunch of brush strokes and maybe a little bit of that imagery back there. What's cool, actually I can't work this close, but what's cool about this is you start to get these just interesting shapes. This play of positive and negative space. And right now I'm keeping the give me something dark. The brushwork very much one of these brushes that I love using. And I think this is a pen and ink brush, and I know it's something that Jamie Jones had created some years. So
that kind of ties into Jinx's question. Do you have a clear image of the final picture when you work on it, or does it evolve as you work on it? And does that change depending on the situation?
I have a clear emotion that I want to capture. And that emotion, and I'll pull back here, is I want to get something that is, and the reason you go really small is because I'll just squint my eyes and I really just want to see these simple shapes. And what I'm looking for is something that is foreboding and dangerous. So you can see that I've started to put these spikes on the edge. I also want it to be very old and ruined, and a sense of monolithic, and it's in a spooky swamp. I don't know if the swamp is spooky, but it is in the swamp, and having seen some of the swamp, it does look kind of spooky. So I want to capture those feeling, and I also want to just give that sense of scale. So here we have a tree, and then you can see that this monolith, the tower of the shuttered eye, is extremely large and towers over the forest behind it. So it's more an emotion. And then I also have an idea of what I want to do compositionally. Yeah, it's kind of sort of, you get the idea. We've got the golden rectangle, your eye flows through the scene. Probably won't follow that exactly. I think I'm going to do something a little different and get some extra trees in the mid-ground here. And then I like to vignette my images. So in the corners, they tend to be a little bit darker and helps your eye focus on the middle. And then also a tilt of the camera. It's called Dutching. And you'll see that from comic book panels, but it gives a sense of danger. So as opposed to, let's go back here to this rough, of being very stoic and unusual in the middle of the swamp, just by simply rotating the image, I get something more dramatic, creepy, kind of dark and spooky. Or at least that's the intent. We'll see how it works on the execution. It doesn't always work the way you want it. So I do like where this is going, but I want to throw in a few more trees here. So I'm going to create a new layer and just let's see where we are. Just get some more shape here. Because it is dangerous, or I want more of a dangerous place, I'm going to have trees here all at different angles, like they've fallen down a bit. And what I'll do is I'll just lighten that a bit. Does that feel good? I'll make it really small, and it does. So I'll just merge these two layers. Rename that base and save it again. I'm also working in full screen mode. And I know for some people, yes, I know, don't show me that again. They like to work just on a black background like this and focus strictly on the art. It works pretty well, but I still use a lot. Like if you're just painting straight, it's cool, but I use a lot of layers and need my tools and functionality. There we go.
I do have a question that came in on the website from Baron Jerkis. He wants to know a little bit more about why it's called the Shuttered Eye and how it fits into the world.
Ooh, so I don't know. What I can say, Baron, is that this is an adventure written by Lord British himself. And the tower predates the Obsidian Order. It was built so far in the past that people are not, it's not anywhere in recorded history. How that ultimately plays into the story, as I said, I actually didn't read it because I didn't want to spoil it for myself. So I don't know if there is going to be more of these kinds of things, these lost indications of some ancient civilization. Actually, I'm sure there will be. Where they are in New Britannia, I don't know. I just know the Tower of the Shuttered Eye is the first one. I hope that helps.
Perfect amount of tease versus spoiler.
Yes. Do we have an ETA on when Tower of the Shuttered Eye is expected to be in the game?
I want to say R15.
R15?
Okay. But I can't remember.
I don't remember myself. R12 puts us on Steam, correct? Pre-alpha?
Yep, our launch is later this month.
Yeah, very exciting.
And you guys, you are backers, people watching. Even though I guess you don't have to be a backer to watch, if you're a backer, you actually get into R12 during our normal window, which is, I think, 4 or 5 days before we launch on Steam. So kind of a head start, which is cool.
Did we get leveling up for R11 or just the basics of it, as I remember? You recall?
I'm sorry, they were talking to me. What was that?
Did we get leveling? Some kind of basic leveling?
Yes, that went in this past release.
Okay. Now, I know further up in the tower, we have like these ledges that are hanging out, but I'm going to go ahead and just put some down here so that you get a sense of that architecture. So it's diverting a little from what the actual production art is. And that's okay, because again, it's a concept. It is designed to wow the community. Production art is designed for the production team to actually make things. Now, there are people who can move just incredibly fast with specific brushes and get a feel for these kinds of things. And I have that ability, but one of the things I love about Pen of the Avatar is just being able to move at a pace that I'm comfortable with and just really focus on the aspects of drawing and painting. It's so rare. Shouldn't say it's so rare.
So actual scene for the Shuttered Eye is supposed to come online for release 12.
At least really?
That's how it was on the schedule.
Okay. But not the actual adventure itself, correct? You can just go.
I don't think it'll be the full adventure. I don't think that'll be implemented. I think that's where the confusion was.
Okay.
Because I know it's got some cool stuff in it that won't quite be ready for R12.
Yeah. I need some white. Gina, are you going to be coming to Austin for Joseph's Hoblob?
I was not able to get affordable plane tickets, so unfortunately not.
It's too bad. Sounds like it's going to be quite the party.
I know. I'm sad. I really wanted to go. And the ironic thing is, if if I had like a month's more notice, I could have gotten really great price for tickets.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, it wasn't confirmed until, it was up in the air for a bit, and then it wasn't confirmed until holiday prices had already kicked in for airfare.
Harvey, don't say that. Doing a little traveling for the holidays. Yeah, I'm actually kind of over.
Amberine would like to correct. It's not hoblob. It's hoblock.
Thank you.
I don't know. I think Joseph would find it amusing having it get quoted as hoblob.
He does not find it amusing. Thank you, Amber. Joseph corrects me every time. Hobloth? Is that what it is?
Correct.
Okay. Now, hoblob is just easier for me. I'm a simple man, all right?
Just playing the booze. It makes you slur your words.
Yes, that's it. So don't I need to slur my words to say hobloff? I don't know if we're going to have him in the game, but I'm going to throw like a crocodile or a couple of crocs hanging out here. That would be kind of cool. Save. Oh. Really. So I've definitely overworked the side here, gotten too carried away, and I just need to simplify it. What I'll do is I'll come back later and get some more detail. Just keep these lines simple. Did you get out and vote today?
I did it earlier. We had early voting. I took advantage of it.
Awesome. Still get a vote for Palin?
Believe it or not, she's not on the ballot up here.
Really? Not even as a write-in? Did you write in? It's voting day. I guess we can talk politics, right? Something you may have noticed is that I'm just working on one layer. I'm just painting on top of everything. And it's intentional. Sometimes you get some interesting mistakes, and when you do, you want to be able to embrace them. It's a spooky swamp. We got to put a spooky squirrel in here.
I am all about the spooky squirrel.
Yes. What did you do for Halloween?
I went to a witch's ball, a formal costume ball. It was great.
Witches as in Wiccan?
No, well, it was a pagan sponsored event. But it was basically hosted by the Witches of Alaska, which is a group. So it's called the Witches Ball. And all of the, like, all the people who worked it were dressed as witches. But it was a full costume ball with formal attire and everything. I got to wear my black evening gown, so that was really exciting.
That's awesome. Yeah. Watched a
movie. I'll take any opportunity to slap on a full-length gown. Anytime, anywhere.
Sounds like a plan. How's this whole thing looking? I know for the community, it's a little easier to see when I'm zoomed in. But when I'm zoomed in, I get a little lose sight of my big shapes. Better. Okay, any thoughts from the community on how we're doing here?
Well, it's varying between talking about the super spooky squirrel and whether it's going to be a spooky secret squirrel, and then we're also discussing now Wiccans, and that there's nothing wrong with Wiccans, and there's not. We're awesome. But I did want to give credit to the pagan community who also co-hosted it with us. We have had some honorary druids that we wove into our midst.
Interesting. I have to say that I watched a fun movie called Witchin' and Bitchin'.
I haven't heard of that one.
It's on Netflix. It's a Spanish film. And it's a comedy. But I got a kick out of it.
The ball was actually on Saturday. So for Halloween, we did the traditional, you know, movie night here at the Dionne's. Not really the Dionne's. Anyway, at our place. And so we had Fright Night on docket because any opportunity to see David Tennant without shirt and leather pants, I mean, just have to. And then, of course, Zombieland is how we ended the evening. Because Zombieland, I mean...
Yeah, my son and his best friend had very clever costumes. They went as plague doctors. And I was really impressed. The fact that an 11-year-old would know what a plague doctor is, let alone want to do that for a costume. And they went out not necessarily trick-or-treating, but they went out to scare people. And so they spent a lot of time just walking around or standing still. And I thought that was different, imaginative. A little more light back here. I'll bring out the tower a bit more, but right, I need a different brush. I'm just going to come up with a it's a soft brush. So this is something that throws me for a generation. I've been working with Photoshop and I'm used to seeing everything black on a very light gray or white in this case. They have now inverted everything, and I'm sure there is a setting to change it. Well, maybe I'm not sure, but it's a little hard to recognize your brushes at first. Took me a bit. So with this background, I just want to soften it up. Get some light in there, get a little bit of depth, and again, I'll hit the corners again just for vignetting, and I think we're in a really good spot there. So let's add some color. And really, thank you. Let's take a look at, if I can open that. Oh, this will be interesting. I have a...
Are you going to actually paint the screen? Sounds like you are scrambling for art supplies.
I'm actually scrambling for a mouse, but my mouse is on a, or my drawing table actually is white, so the mouse doesn't work on white, so I've got to get my little black mouse pad over here so it will work. And then we can take a look at this. Okay, so this is the swamp reference folder that I'm taking a look at. And I don't know what that came from, but I like the Payne's gray blue here in the background, and then this very muted ochre here in the foreground. I think that looks cool. Mangrove swamps, you can see with low water, all the roots are exposed, and then you can see, you know, everything that's muddy are pretty much the same color, that the water line actually comes up midway there, covers all the roots. Let's see, that's a main core. This was just a beautiful pastel painting that someone did of a swamp. I really liked it. It's rich, bright, and happy. We're not going for it, but I like his use of color in here and almost this electric blue sky. Lots of algae and slime on the cypress trees. Some more splotted stuff, so I definitely want to do something like that. And when you look at the swamp, this background just becomes a wall of trees. Everything just gets lost in there. Someone's cool art. Don't know why that's in there. Another really nice swamp painting. This is beautiful and lush. A little richer than we want to go. This is, who is this by? Lewis Scaldill. This is a beautiful painting or illustration of Gollum in the Mirror of Dead Men.
Wow, that is stunning.
Yes, and I love these trees, and I love this palette, so I want to go with something along those lines. The rest of this gets a little... I don't know why that's in there, too. Or that. So sometimes when I'm saving out reference... here we go. These are screenshots of a work in progress of the swamp in the game. And I love this ochre color that we have. So somewhere between what we have or going to have in the game for the swamp, and you can see that this is the screenshot that I threw in the background that I started with. And where's that blue one? And then this kind of Payne's gray blue. So next thing I'm going to do is create a layer called color, and I'm going to set it to overlay. And just using my soft brush, I'm going to grab some color. And that Payne's gray tends to be a little bluish green. Definitely on the gray side. I'm just going to throw it in there. Actually, I could probably just fill it. And so now we've got a beautiful color going. And now I want to get some of that ochre feel, and it's kind of this green, gray, I'm not sure. Start to bring that in here. Now, this thing has existed for thousands of years in the mythology, so it's going to be covered with moss. So I'm definitely going to be liberal with the getting the color on there. I think I'll keep the blue here.
So we're having a debate in chat. Wrath Phoenix wanted to point out that the swamp would have overrun the tower in that amount of time. And so I brought up the counter argument, because I'm a writer and that's what I do, that maybe the tower emits a dark energy that keeps the swamp at bay. Something to noodle.
Right.
Maybe it just looks cool this way.
Yeah. It's a fantasy game. Dark Phoenix, don't overthink it. So I'm with you on that suspension of disbelief, and honestly, you've got a pretty valid point. So let's definitely get a lot of green on there. Gina, you're right too. There could be a lot of reasons why it hasn't been overgrown yet. Dark energy sounds cool. There's certainly something special about this tower. So finding out what that is definitely a big part of what the players are going to be doing. Okay. So feeling good about that.
Oh, I'm sorry, that was not Wrath Phoenix. That was Rhea. And I apologize if I ever misquote you. I've got literally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 windows open right now, 9 windows open right now with different people trying to talk to me.
We only have 9 people in chat. Get your phones. We need more.
I know. I've got multitasking down to an art, but I still mess up sometimes. So I do apologize, Rhea, for misquoting you.
Oh, hey, I'm actually getting questions here in the window that I had covered up with the navigator.
Oh, no, I already asked those. I just put them there for me so they don't scroll away during the course of the conversation.
Rhea asked if I have the same PC at home as at work. No. This one is 5 years out of date, and I definitely need to build a new rig. I've only got 6 gigs of RAM, and my new machine is going to have 32. i7, I think this is a Pentium quad core, if I remember. So 5 years ago was awesome. Now, not so much. Okay, so we've got a base, and I actually want to try some things just using brushes. So I'm going to find, hopefully I can find, I think it's this brush. Give me a second. I'm losing some sunlight in here. We've been having rain, which is kind of nice.
Yesterday here had to be the most dreary, overcast, it was literally just gray. Today is gorgeous. There's not a cloud in the sky, vibrant blue. We still haven't had a proper snowfall yet, which is pretty surprising. There's little patches of snow on the ground from a flurry a couple weeks ago that hasn't quite melted, but I've been quite surprised how mild it's been so far. I guess I should knock on wood.
Yes. Enjoy it. We finally enjoyed cool weather. My son and I ran some errands Saturday, decided to stop to get a cheeseburger. And at the We have a local place called Mighty Fine All Natural Beef. It's a tasty cheeseburger. And
I miss Mighty Fine Burgers.
He and
you
I
have
are
no idea. There is not a decent burger place.
Not even
Elk the burger? Best burger place out here is Red Robin, and that's saying something because it's not that good. That's one of the places I'm going to hit on my trip back to Austin.
Not so crazy about that. Delete. Okay, so what I want to do is get a sense of, some moss on the stone. I was going to say it was just shy of 70, and he and I are in shorts and t-shirts sitting outside eating our sandwich while there are people wearing winter coats and hats inside.
I never understood that about Austin. I never, and maybe because I lived in a cooler climate, I never felt cold enough to put a sweater on. When I came up here, I had to buy a complete new sweater wardrobe because I didn't have any.
Right.
And I actually had to buy long pants. And what's up with that? Long pants.
Let's see. Be a little too much.
So Artemis brings up a question. It's kind of a blast from a past. We have concepting over the past year, and he's interested if things that you drew in earlier episodes, like the giant worms, the dryads, were accepted as content into the game, and if they would be making an appearance in episode one or maybe a further episode out.
I'm going to say episode two. So, because we're crowdfunded, we're very limited on what we can produce, and a lot of the creatures that we're facing in the game are repurposed art that we purchased, and we just did that out of necessity. We certainly have a few unique things in the game. The mimics are in there, and they're a lot of fun, and I believe we have different variations on those. My brain's not really in that spot right now. It seems to me that there are some other things that are in too. I just can't think of them at the moment. Gina, can you help me out? Oh, the liches.
I don't know which ones we can reveal, because I know they are holding some back as a surprise. Well, not a surprise, but they're trying to introduce them and spotlight them as they go in. So, I don't know what I can say.
The nature of what we do.
I would hate to have to banhammer myself for misspeaking.
Right. No, you gave it away. What? Let's see what this one does. Yeah. Looks like leaves. Something dark there. Why aren't you showing up? Brush for painting trees.
So they're begging me to tell them some secrets, and they never send me any booze. So I don't know why I would be inclined to sell, you know, to share secrets. Right. Maybe more of my perks.
That's right.
Even though Duke Violation, bless his heart, sent me some coffee, some gourmet coffee. That was nice.
Awesome. Let's see what this one does. Oh, I've got the opacity down. No wonder everything's... Oh, boy, did I just mess up the horizon. Yep. Ah! Let me undo all of that. Yeah. Okay, so I want to reinforce that horizon. Come on. There we go. And a solid line in there so we don't lose it again. There we go. Gina, what's your favorite feature that you're looking forward to in Release 12?
I'm looking forward to seeing the new areas come online. That's always really exciting for me.
Yeah.
I swooned when Virtus Pass came online. And then the swamp was just amazing. And so I'm really looking forward. I like discovering new places and seeing how players react to that. That's a lot of fun for me.
Yes. There are a lot of new places. Okay. So I'm going to shrink this up really small. Hello. Oh, better save it. So now, I know that's really teeny, but I do this. So now I can see that, yes, that tower is definitely the prominent shape. The strongest lights and darks are on either side of the tower to help bring it out. We've got some depth going in the swamp. Definitely, I think maybe this middle one here, I will, make him a little smaller, just push him back a bit. I suppose if this was a speed painting, I could just throw in some characters and And you get right in here, you can see that these are just loose brush strokes, which is a good thing. You want art to look like art. Wow, I forgot where I was going. Speed painting. The details, that sort of thing. How was everyone's reaction to Solish Bridge?
I know the players were having a lot of fun with it during the release.
Good.
Got a question from Artemis. It's about the mainland. There might not be a lot we can tell you, Artemis. I know there's a lot of the mainland we as players have not seen yet, but have you, Steve, been finished most of the concepting for episode one yet, or is there still a way to go?
I have finished most of the concepting for episode one, and right now it's just a matter of, you know, what's needed or something that comes up or a new idea, that kind of thing. So a lot of what we're seeing is the finished, can't say that because the game's not finished. What am I trying to say? A lot of what you're seeing is what you're going to be seeing in the finished game, just multiplied by, 4,000? 3,000? We have a crazy amount of hex in the game. And each one of those with the encounter and adventure system they're setting up is going to have different elements in it. So it's going to be pretty amazing. Okay, so I know this is very monochromatic, but if I come in here and get some, you know, rich green, I better create another layer. I do something like that. Some ivy and just moss all over this place. You get a sense of where that's going and how that's going to pop once all that luscious green is added to it. It's probably a little too hot, but you get the idea.
Yeah, I've got to agree with Drokus. He just said, I love that tower. It has an old school D&D flavor to it. And it really does. It makes you want to see what's inside.
Yeah, I actually, when I posted it on Facebook, I said, we're venturing into the vast swamp to explore the tomb of dot, dot, dot. I mean, the Tower of the Shuttered Eye. Yes, it does have a classic D&D feel to it. I think that's a good thing. Okay. Let's see if we play a little. Let's go to reference, rocks. And a nice rock surface. I like this rock wall. The heck, just bringing it all over. I'm gonna set this to overlay, and look, we get instant stone. There's almost a perspective thing there. So I'm going to find a good position for that. I'm going to use my stamp tool. And yes, I know. And just do a little bit of stamping here. And then I want to take what's happening here and just reinforce that perspective. Okay. All that rock texture. And then we will go and carve it out with our eraser. Oops. Who says oops?
There is a request for a burning toad in a swamp.
Burning toad? I'm going to set this back to normal, and you can see what in the image we're actually using in just kind of grab a little bit of that. And cover it up, and I like what's happening here, so I think I'll grab this and do a little bit of that over there. Go ahead and send that back to overlay, and okay, my concern is that is just, it's killing too much of the paint. So I'm going to go ahead and erase away some more here. It's like getting that extra noise where the rocks are feels good, but killing the the brush strokes, it starts to get to be too much. So. I do get some interesting shapes coming out of there, and certainly down here as we go into the swamp, get a real nice sense of what shapes could be. I'm just kind of killing everything in the shadows. I'm going to erase most of it. And then there. Let's come over here. Get rid of that. And too much detail in the corner. When everything is said and done, normal. It's about how much I'm using of the photo reference. It's really the way these rocks are here is very helpful and interesting, very natural, because it's rocks. And then this bit of noise added on top of the painting is looking good. So go ahead and set that back to overlay. And I'm just going to save that. What are we doing for time? We got a little over 30 minutes, so I'm going to start with the hot layer. Actually, let's go with two.
That's my favorite layer, the hot layer.
Yes. Some like it hot. Set that to color dodge and color dodge. So for this first one, I'm just going to use a big, soft airbrush, and I want some kind of green color, greenish yellow, sickly, but I want to increase the saturation there.
So we have a question about the tower from Jinx, who asks, would the tower be whole or is the top broken?
Oh, no, the tower is whole. It is...
it's got that dark mojo going, remember?
Right. This is the kind of thing you're going to see.
So. See, what I wonder is, does it get scarier the further up you go?
Ooh, I don't know. How far are you willing to go? Okay, so I like that, but I don't like the green because I want to keep the blue back there. So I'm going to go somewhere in there, pop up the saturation, darken it a little, get that thing going on, and then hotter, just going to go to more of a detailed brush here. And then I am going to start bringing out some of this detail.
Apologize in advance because my birds are on a rampage. Jinx wants to know, how tall the tower is, how many stories it is. Ooh. Nope, that was Dracus. Sorry about that. He estimates 5 stories. I said it looks a little taller than 5 stories. Do you know how many stories it's meant to be?
Certainly meant to be tall. It's meant to be taller than the trees. And
no, you guys can't have an elevator. Maybe a teleporter. But that takes all the fun out of it.
So you see what that hot layer does. It just really brings out the stone saturation down on it. Gets things popping quite a bit. How tall? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'll say 8 to 10 stories. So 80 to 120 feet. How's that sound? That's a guess, though.
Yeah, that looks about right.
Oh, I did keep that layer. Yay. So we'll call this Ivy. Let's see what it's doing there for the scene. Now what I'm going to do is just copy that layer, all the color out of it. And I'll put it underneath the Ivy. And then I'll move it based on where the light is. Let's do a filter, blur, Gaussian, let's just say 4. Yeah, that was too much. Let's do filter blur, Gaussian, let's just make that 2. And you can see that gives us a little bit of a drop shadow. Just kind of put that underneath. Adjust the opacity a bit and merge it with the Ivy layer. And that's just going to help pop the Ivy off the scene there. So it's giving our scene some depth. Let's see here. So the next thing I want to do is add, feel like I'm losing my flow. So I'm going to turn my guide back on, and I'm just going to come in here and get an idea where I want to go. If that's my horizon line, and I've got this staircase here, it's coming down. Some kind of platform there, and then I want it to move back. There we go. So this is kind of how I want the view, the flow to go in this scene here. And it certainly can be broken a bit by these trees, and certainly some shadows. And so I'm just going to control U, bring up my hue saturation, make that white, control U, get a little darker, kind of a shade of gray. And then image adjustment, and they don't have variations anymore. I wonder if it's vibrance. Image adjustment, variables. No.
Jinx asks, Fire Lotus, would this image be available as concept art for us to download? He would love it as wallpaper. We tend to post concept art to the forums in a particular order, like new art like this. So first it would go to DevPlus, and that usually happens while it's in process. So Stephen will post the first image, and then he'll continue posting updates as he creates them. And then once it is complete, it will go to the Founders Forum, where there's an art gallery. And it'll spend a couple weeks to a month there before I upload it to the web page in the concept art of the media gallery. And at that time, it's open to anyone to download and all that fun stuff. So there's your answer. Kind of long-winded, but...
Yes, and I am going to have this up in the DevPlus gallery before the end of the week. Okay, so I'm going to shrink it up like that. I like where that is going. Looking very painterly, ancient, spooky, and dark. Maybe we'll turn that down just a bit. And where's our ivy at? Thinking about what you're doing and what you want to convey is very important. So don't be afraid to stop. Take a break. Give it some thought. I also want to be consistent with the other swamp image I've created. Take a look at that just for comparison. It's like, okay, yeah, there's a lot of detail in that. A little more defined shapes. So I think that's where we need to go next. And actually, I'm just going to create another layer. I'm going to go in there with a black brush, and I'm actually just going to use a pen or a point. And we'll go to 200 and start to ivy's kind of throwing me, but I think it'll be all right. I'm just going to reinforce some of the things happening here in the shadows. And I'm not crazy about that brush, so I'm going to go back to my old tried and true. Need to do a little carving out this edge more defined. So we want to make it a soft edge. I always tell when I start thinking about what I'm doing, my voice gets softer. Focus on the art.
We have a few requests. Wrath Phoenix would like a snake or water moccasin just under the water, making ripples in the moss.
Okay.
Sphinx would like some spider webs in the trees.
All right. Spider webs in the trees is probably a level of fidelity that's beyond what I want to capture here, but certainly snakes in the water. Get that in there. I have a water moccasin story. Many years ago, when I was working offshore for Mobil Oil Corporation, that'll tell you how old this story is because they've been Mobil Exxon or Exxon Mobil for quite a long time. We're in the swamps of Louisiana and came across a water moccasin nestled around a wellhead. Snuggled, not nestled. And my coworker, the adventurous sort, grabs a sucker. And so there we are with a 4-foot moccasin, water moccasin, and I'm not sure what to do. So we look in the trunk and find a pair of scissors and snip the head off the thing. Well, snakes have a natural defense where they will omit their odor. And this thing was very...
Oh, yes.
Sprayed him. I got a little bit. He got all of it. And for the rest of the day, we were in this little trailer working and putting information and needed to... It was a bit robust. It smelled pretty bad of snake. I smelled bad of snake. And what was fascinating is that head kept going for hours. You had to be very careful because it was still snapping and releasing poison.
One thing that really freaks me out about water moccasins that not everybody knows is they can climb really, really well. And it's not uncommon to see them on the sides of buildings because they can climb straight up as long as there's a texture for their belly scales to hold on to. So there's nothing more humbling than looking up at the side of a house and there's a snake about 8 feet up. That could fall on you. Yeah, that's part of the joy of living in Florida.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, I would flip out. Not cool. Not cool at all. All right. So we got about 15, 20 minutes left, and I definitely want to do a recap of what we've done. Do we have some more questions from the community?
I think the consensus is that your friend was not a very bright person.
No.
Everyone has one of those friends, though.
He definitely had some cojones. He was born and raised in Texas, outside of Houston. Actually, I think Victoria. And
oh, well, there you go. Not much scares him, then.
Right. He grew up around snakes. So it's, we all have our things. I grew up in Colorado, so climbing and driving on high altitude roads, yeah. Crazy heights, no problem.
Anne Moraine wants you to go into deep thought a little more often when you're on Pen of the Avatar. I think she likes the, we all like the personal stories and experiences. Because you've had a really interesting life. And you tell really good stories.
Thank you. My favorite stories from my time working offshore were all the places I got sick. It was down off South Padre Island. I was inventorying a platform and wandering around the platform, and I get up to the trailer, the break room, and the phone's ringing. Answer the phone and get this angry guy on the other end on the radio saying, "Where have you been?" "Doing my job." He's like, "There's going to be a bird there in 5 minutes for you. You've got to be on it." I'm like, I'm not done. It's like, "There's a storm coming." All right. I didn't think much about it. And up until that point, it had been a crystal clear blue sky, just gorgeous. You're out on the water. You see maybe another platform or two on the horizon where my coworkers are at, and that's it. I'm looking around. I'm thinking, "What the hell is he talking about? Storm. Gorgeous." I turn around, do a 180, and coming out of the west is just a wall of black. Wrath of God storm. Massive clouds from one end of the horizon to the other end with flashes of lightning in them. Spielberg would have been in awe. Thinking, damn, that is a storm. You don't think that stuff exists until you actually see it. It blew me away. So, helicopter shows up. I'm on it. We pick up the rest of the team, and we try and outrun the storm. We head south. We actually land in Brownsville, Texas. And if you're familiar with the Gulf Coast, there's North Padre Island, South Padre Island, and then you go down to Brownsville on the Mexican border. And trying to wait out the storm, but it's not letting up. And there is policy at that time that if you're working for Mobile Oil, you have to spend the night on Mobile Oil property. So they make the call that they've got to ride back through the storm to the production platform where we were stationed. And most of the pilots I met in that time, this is 89-90, were all veterans who had flown in Vietnam. And our pilot is giddy. He's all excited. He's like, "Yeah, we got to go back." Big smile on his face, and we fly into the storm. Crazy wind, pouring rain. Helicopter is just getting bounced around like no tomorrow. And after about 90 minutes, we can finally see the platform where we're going to stay. We're getting close, and at that point, I just lose it, and I throw up in my hard hat. And everyone laughs. It was like, kid couldn't make it. Lost his lunch. We get to the platform, and getting in and out of a helicopter, you always want to have the blades either stopped or moving at full speed, because those blades actually dip down. And like when you see people ducking to get in and out of a helicopter, that is to avoid the blades dipping down. So the door's open. I step out with my hard hat full of puke, and the winds blow the puke all over the team. They did not think that was funny. But at that point, I got a kick out of it. It was just one of those moments where you didn't think it could get worse, and then it did. What else? I threw up in a seaplane.
You know, they should have totally been grateful you didn't puke on them. You had the sense to puke into your hard hat.
Yeah, but then it got splashed all over them when we landed.
Well, see, to me, that's just a little bit karma.
Yes. So I got seasick on a boat, and honestly, not even a storm, just rough weather. That was not good. That was the one and only time I've been seasick. And if you've ever been seasick, you know what I'm talking about. You know when you're sick and you get that sense of nauseousness in your gut? When you're seasick, it's throughout your body and your extremities. You can feel that feeling in your toes and your fingers. And to function when you feel like that is... you got to be a badass. One of the guys I worked with was in the Navy during World War II, and he was talking about how there was a time, he grew up on boats and ships, but there was a storm so bad where like 80% of the people were sick. He's like, and during that, you don't have a choice. You got to keep functioning. You got to keep doing your job. It's like, yeah, it's not fun. All right, so I'm feeling good where we're at. And just that, let me zoom in so you can see where that. So that level of detail, taking all that painterly work and then going in there and just drawing on top of it to give it more definition of what you see in the scene. So let's go back and recap. Here we have the Tower of the Shuttered Eye in a swamp. This is the production image, and you can see the variations and the initial roughs. Inspired by Orfunk, coming up with some variations of towers. Richard makes a call, get some more feedback, make it spookier, more interesting, and ultimately end on this final tower and create something in the swamp. This production art goes to the production team, and they start building the tower off that image. We want to create a splash image, and that is much more of a painting used for marketing purposes and to get people excited about what the adventure is going to be. Here's the rough that I worked up, and you can see I've Dutched it a bit to give it a little more drama. Excuse me. I've thrown the tower in there, but I do. And then I painted on top to loosen it up, and then I adjusted the perspective using our guide here. And see what's going on there, and that gives us a sense of our painting, and then we've got the base, and then I start painting on top of that. I think we can probably zoom in a little more for folks watching. So do some more painting on top of that. I'm just using different brushes. I want the backgrounds to feel like trees. I want the foreground here to get some rock, that sort of thing. And then I just find a photograph of a rock and set that to overlay to give some nice texture and more shapes that you'll see in the painting. Did a hot layer, and then a hotter layer to help bring out some of our stone here. Threw on some ivy to green it up because it's ancient, it's been there for a while. Lighting up in specific places because this is how I want your eye to move through the scene. And then we start painting in some detail on top of that. And I'm actually going to add one more thing. I'm just going to make this red because about the size of a person. So have our adventurers making their way up to the tower. Talked about snakes in the water. Put those in there, and then I also want to get some crocodiles here. They've come out to sunbathe. And I'm just kind of drawing this from memory. I'll get some photo reference when I do that. But I want snakes, I want crocodiles. I'm going to turn on my golden ratio again. The focal point is right here, so I think what I'll do is bring this crocodile over here. Something like that.
I really like the crocodiles.
Yeah, I think that's going to be good. Maybe move these people down here so they're a little closer. And honestly, I think I have a big group of people just kind of moving through the swamp there. Okay. It's a snake. Not cool. Here, okay, there, and a little snake, something like that. I put those just in red, so it's like, yes, if I just do them in black, I might forget what these squiggles are supposed to be, but if I do them in red, and actually maybe I'll put a little eye on these guys, some sharp teeth. Eat people. A little eye there. That's going to remind me that these are snakes in the water. And yes, it looks pretty silly, but that's just... That is so I can remember. And also play with that composition. It's like, yeah, that's all working fine. And it's more, yeah, it's probably a little more something like that. Maybe I'll take this lead person here and just put them down there. I know it doesn't seem like much, but that's actually better. I still want to have a couple people. There we go. We've got a big party going to the Tower of the Shuttered Eye.
It's a popular place.
Yes, it is. All right, let me just adjust here. I'll switch back momentarily. I have to work on my setup a bit. All right, community. We got just a couple minutes. Anything else from the community? Gina, questions?
They're talking about eels now. They're saying that some of them looked like eels and not snakes. And they're red right now. They don't look like anything other than shapes. Relax. It's coming.
It is. Ah, gotta listen. It's all right. Community, thanks for being here with us. I'm Steven Dinelli, concept art lead for Shroud of the Avatar, and we'll see you next time. Again, thank you for supporting us.
Don't forget, if you're here in Austin, flashback for the Austin Children's Services is in February, February 21st. Find out more about it on Facebook. And the Hobloff is coming in 2 weeks. Hobloff, is that it? All right. I'd rather call it Hobloff. I love you, Joseph. And what was the other thing? Oh, breast cancer. Cancer in general. We're all dealing with it. Do what you can to support and fight the good fight. That's all I got.
Thank you guys for joining us. We will see you soon. Take care.